Hey, good morning, friends. Derek from Bomb Socks with more Bomb Bites, where we feast upon the words of Christ one bite at a time. Okay, so yesterday we talked about this this idea of the Lord giving us the kingdom, but in doing so, what he requires of us is, like we talked about, this great work that we need to do, but here's what he requires of us. You go to verse number 34, and he says, "Behold, the Lord requireth the heart and a willing mind, and the willing and obedient shall eat the good of the land of Zion in these days." Well, let me show you this little picture right here. You have the heart and a willing mind. I love them holding the hands, so cute. So what does the heart symbolize? Well, the heart symbolizes the emotional and moral facet of a person. It is one's innermost character, feelings, and inclination. So that is your feels there. The mind, it is the cognitive and rational facet of a person. It thinks, it perceives, it wills, and it reasons. And so the Lord is requiring the way that we feel and the way that we reason, and we put those two things together. And that is what is going to really help us understand what he really expects out of us. So with that in mind, there are two things I think that really require our heart and our willing mind. The first one I want to focus on right here is found in section 64, verses 5 through 11. So verse 5, "The keys and the mysteries of the kingdom shall not be taken from my servant Joseph Smith through the means I have appointed while he liveth, inasmuch as he obeyeth mine ordinances." Verse 6, "But there are those who have sought occasion against him without cause. Nevertheless, if he has sinned, but verily I say unto you, I, the Lord, forgive sins unto those who confess their sins before me and ask forgiveness who have not sinned unto death. My disciples in days of old sought occasion against one another and forgave not one another in their hearts. For this evil, they were afflicted and sorely chastened." So as you can see in these verses, early members of the church were starting to have some issues with Joseph for whatever reasons. Some of it were just some basic character flaws. Others were his lack of education, but people were starting to really give Joseph some grief. Some people that were actually close to him in the church as well. And we'll talk more about that in these coming episodes. But here's the Lord saying, look, you guys got to stop doing this. Just like my disciples of old, they did it. You guys are doing it too. I forgave them and I will forgive you, but you also have to forgive one another. Look at verse 9. "Wherefore I say unto you that ye ought to forgive one another. For he that forgiveth not his brother his trespasses standeth condemned before the Lord, for there remaineth in him the greater sin. I, the Lord, will forgive whom I will forgive, but of you it is required to forgive all men. And ye ought to say in your hearts, let God judge between me and thee, and reward thee according to thy deeds." When you are unwilling to forgive someone, here is the Lord saying, look, I will forgive whom I will forgive, but of you it is required to forgive all men. So the question is this: how can unforgiveness be greater than the thing that the person actually did? So you look at the Ten Commandments. The very first commandment is, thou shalt have no other gods before me. When we are saying that we are not going to forgive someone, we are putting ourselves as a higher judge than God. I'm pretty sure we're breaking a pretty hefty commandment right there. So I have this written in my scriptures. Do not burden yourselves any longer with unforgiveness. Let God, the perfect judge, do what he does so well. So there's a lot of messages out there. There's great messages that have been done, some a little bit lengthy. I would recommend to you, go out there and search through the Saints channel, formerly known as the Mormon channel. Search forgiveness. And you're going to see some wonderful messages. Some heart-wrenching messages, but you're going to see some great inspiring messages that I think will help you and I in our quest to be able to grow closer to Jesus Christ with our hearts and our willing minds. So in October of 2018, Elder Holland gave a talk called The Ministry of Reconciliation. And there's an article that was written about this that kind of referred to this talk a little bit. And I love this. It talks about two aspects of what Elder Holland focused on. So we often hear the term forgive and forget. This implies that when someone wrongs us, we should forgive them and forget that it ever happened. This phrase can be problematic because it implies that feelings we had surrounding the situation are insignificant or invalid. But Elder Holland uses a different phrase. Forgive and forsake is what he talked about. The word forsake means to abandon. You are allowed to feel all the feelings your heart is experiencing. Isn't that wonderful? Your experiences are valid and important, and your pain is absolutely real. But when we forgive and forsake, We forgive the person and abandon the negative feelings and pain caused by that person. You can forgive and leave your pain in the past. Now, there's this thing called the science of forgiveness as well, referring to his talk. Forgiveness is just as much, if not more, for yourself as it is for the other person involved. The American Psychological Association published an article on how forgiveness affects mental and physical health. It states, forgiveness is linked to mental health outcomes such as reduced anxiety, depression, and other major psychiatric disorders, as well as fewer physical health symptoms and lower mortality rates. With medical proof to illustrate the physical benefits of forgiveness, it's difficult to imagine why anyone would hold a grudge or harbor feelings of resentment for another person. But we fear that forgiving someone who wronged us will invalidate our very real feelings and excuse the other person's behavior. This isn't the case, as Elder Holland so gently reminded us. We are allowed to feel pain. Pain, however, is not meant to last forever, and we were meant to be happy. The scriptures teach us, Adam fell that men might be, and men are that they might have joy. Elder Holland notes that the only way to rise above our pain is to walk the path of forgiveness and healing that Jesus Christ first walked. And so that requires the heart and a willing mind to be able to do that. Like I said, go find one of those messages out there and watch them, and watch how that person did exactly that thing. It is not easy, but it requires a willing mind and it requires the heart. So anyway, I know that's a tough one. It might be one of the most difficult things that you do on this earth. Forgiveness requires a God. It requires the God to be able to help you through it. I don't think you can do it by yourself. It also requires time. It requires patience. But it can be done and it must be done in order for us to really have the Lord give us the kingdom. I really believe that's true. Hey, thanks so much for watching. Thanks for subscribing and thanks for sharing. We will see you tomorrow with another thing that requires the heart and willing mind. Godspeed. Bye-bye.